Excellent. Okay, so we have this second talk by Axel Kleinschmidt, and the title, as you can see, is E11 Exception Field Theory. Please, Axel.
Should I start already? Okay.
Yes, I think you can. Please.
Okay, very good. So, well, thank you very much to the organizers for the opportunity to speak here. And I will report on some work that has been going on over the last few years with Guillaume Bossard and Ergen Seskin. And also there's a prior paper that I will use to some extent with also with Jakob Palmquist and Christopher Pope. And since the topic of the, or the title of the seminar is E11 Exceptional Field Theory, and maybe it's not immediately obvious to everybody in the audience what exceptional field theory refers to here, I will spend the first few minutes giving some motivation and context for the work that I will describe. I should say there were two talks already by Edvard Nazaev and Ilya Bakhmatov on Monday that are related to this, but still I think I will probably take a moment to paint a bigger picture. So the context of this work is that something that has been well known for over 40 years, that is, if you take the maximal supergravity theory in 11 dimensions and perform a toroidal reduction on a torus Tn, so an n-dimensional torus, Cremer and Julliard realized in the late 70s that you get, first of all, a maximally supersymmetric gravity theory in the reduced dimensions, so in 11 minus n. But the surprising result that they found is that this theory has a global symmetry, and this global symmetry is an exceptional symmetry En. And the way that this global symmetry acts is it acts nonlinearly on the scalars, and it acts linearly on all the vectors, two forms, three forms, and so on. So when you do the reduction of maximal supergravity in the 11 dimensions, you generate a certain field content, some of which we will see later, and there's an action of the symmetry on all these fields. And this is something that has now been called the En tensor hierarchy. So the very specific pattern of fields that you see in maximal supergravity in 11 minus n dimension is very well classified by certain structures called the tensor hierarchy. And let me also quickly say how this how you can understand at least part of this global symmetry. And part of the global symmetry is just an echo of the local symmetries before you do the toroidal compactification. And to explain this, imagine that the 11-dimensional space-time is just factored or maybe fibered with this torus that you want to reduce on. And you split the 11-dimensional coordinates into what I will call external coordinates, x mu, and then torus coordinates, y m. And in particular, there's sort of an internal part of the 11-dimensional metric, GMN. So this is only along the torus direction. But in 11 dimensions, it still depends on all the coordinates. And under 11-dimensional diffeomorphisms, it simply transforms with the Lie derivative. And this is the standard formula for the Lie derivative. And here I'm assuming that the parameter of the diffeomorphism is only along the torus direction. Now, what happens if you do this reduction is that you assume nothing depends on y, so you lose this this coordinate here, and these internal components of the metric, of course, they are scalar fields now on the reduced in the reduced theory. And if you moreover take the very specific diffeomorphism parameter psi, which is just a constant matrix in GLN times the torus coordinates, then this will lead to the fact that here these terms, when you take derivative of xi, they will just be this constant matrix lambda. And the first term, because nothing depends on the torus coordinates, just goes away. So in this way, you can get from the diffeomorphisms in 11 dimensions, just a global action of a GLN subgroup of En on the metric. So this internal metric is part of the scale. These are parts of the scalar fields that you have in this tensor hierarchy. And you can do play a similar game, because in 11 dimensions, you also have a gauge field. So you have more local symmetries in 11 dimensions. And when you do this, you get more transformations of En. But this explains only what is called a parabolic subgroup of En. And the true observation, or the interesting observation by Cremer and Julliard, was that there are more so-called hidden transformations that complete the symmetries in lower dimensions to the exceptional group En. And whereas what I was saying before only depended on the symmetries, on the local symmetries in 11 dimensions, the existence of these extra hidden transformations requires that you know something about the details of the theory. So in particular, you have to have a very specific matter coupling, the John Simons term, with a specific coefficient in 11 dimensions for this to be true. But these transformations, they are of course very important in the context of U-duality, or if you're interested just in solutions in supergravity or in gravity, these are sometimes called Ehlers transformation or Harrison transformation. So they're very useful and interesting things. So this has been known for some time, and you can ask the question, I gave you an explanation of sort of some of the EN transformations from symmetries in higher dimensions, the other, the hidden ones, is there a similar origin that you could find for them? And this is a question that has been asked by many people over the years, and here I listed some of the most important people who asked this question. Now, and one affirmative answer to this question is provided by exceptional geometry. So this is a version of a generalized complex geometry or generalized geometry. And there's also something that I will explain which goes with this, which is exceptional field theory. And in some sense, it's very easy to say what this is. Now, this exceptional geometry, it's just taking the formula that I had before and replacing everything by EN objects. So now instead of just taking the internal part of the metric, I take all the scalar fields. So these scalar fields are sort of a generalized metric given in terms of a generalized field line V, which is related to the symmetric space of EN. K of EN is the maximal compact subgroup. I write down a diffeomorphism in terms of some generalized Lie derivative acting on this generalized metric, which consists of a transport term as any Lie derivative. And then there will be an action, an EN valued action with a parameter, which is just sort of d xi. And if you take the toroidal reduction of this, then this will become the correct global action. So saying this is very obvious, but there is a small catch to what I'm saying, namely that this d xi here is, if you only consider the torus coordinates ym, there's no way that you can build an en valued parameter out of it. So you want to describe an action of the exceptional symmetry on these generalized metric scalars. But if you only consider the torus coordinates, you cannot construct a parameter that does it. And the solution is that you have to enlarge the space. So you take the torus coordinates ym and embed them in a larger space, whose coordinates I will call capital Y capital M. And they transform into a certain representation of the symmetry group. So R1 labels a certain representation of the EN symmetry group. And to give you an idea, here are some instances of this representation. So for E6, it would be the 27-dimensional representation and so on. These are the representations that people find they have to use, and they are also related to this tensor hierarchy algebra that I was, mentioning before. In the table here, you also see a second representation showing up R2, which is just another set of representations of these exceptional groups. And their role is the following, because now I've described to you how you can define by extending the space, this generalized Lie derivative on the generalized metric. You have to ask, is this a consistent set of gauge transformations? So do these generalized Lie derivatives form a nice algebraic structure? We are, of course, in Riemannian geometry, we know that we have a Lie bracket structure for the Lie derivative, but with these new generalized Lie derivatives, it's not so clear. And the role of this representation R2 is that you can use this to close the algebra by imposing what is known as the section constraint. So this section constraint means that with this tensor product, if you take a derivative in these extended coordinates acting on one field and another derivative acting on the same or another field, it doesn't matter. This is what the tensor product means. And in this tensor product, the components along this representation R2, they have to vanish. If this is satisfied, then the algebra closes. And this is this you can show by explicit calculation easily all the way up to E7. And I will come back to what goes wrong later. So the good thing is this constraint here is completely invariant under EN. under the symmetry group, because I've just written things in representations and decomposed representations. So this imposing this constraint does not break the symmetry, so you can write everything using EN tensor calculus. But I want to emphasize that if you want to solve this constraint, so this is something you have to impose sort of from the outside on the geometry, and one way of solving this is taking only the torus coordinates, YM, you automatically break the symmetry group again. So you can write down something that is covariant when you formulate it, but any solution will spontaneously break the symmetry. Good. Now we have a consistent algebra of transformations, and we have an object, namely this generalized metric on which these V derivatives act. And now, of course, you want to construct a theory out of this. And if this was the ordinary metric and the ordinary V derivative, we all would say, okay, the clear theory we want to write down is general relativity. So what is the replacement of general relativity in this exceptional geometry context? And this is the question that is answered by exceptional field theory, and exceptional field theory also takes this, not only this generalized metric, but it also takes the external metric and the vector fields and the two forms. So all the other fields you know from supergravity, puts them together. And if there's a unique answer then to the question, with these symmetries, what is the theory? And this is exceptional field theory, and was very much developed by Hohm and Samtleben all the way up to E8. So this theory is uniquely fixed by the symmetries. And what is interesting is that here I wrote down this constraint, this section constraint, which was EN invariant. And I can choose different solutions to this constraint. And one solution will reproduce for me 11-dimensional supergravity. Another solution will reproduce type 2B supergravity. So these slightly different theories, they're all incorporated into the same general model. Now, when you go to E8, I was saying up here that this algebra of symmetry transformation only closes up to E7. So when you go to E8, you have to work a bit harder, and this working a bit harder is reflected in the fact that the algebra needs some ancillary gauge parameters. So there's more gauge symmetry that you need to parameterize slightly differently to close the algebra. And this ancillary gauge symmetry is related to something that is known as a constrained field. This is not something that is appearing in supergravity, that only this only appears in exceptional field theory. And when I say constrained field, I mean constrained in the sense that it carries an index which satisfies this equation up here. So the field has some kind of a vector index, if you wish, or form index under this extended geometry. And whenever you see a combination that satisfies this equation, you can set it to zero. This is a constrained field. And something that has been observed also recently is that these constraints, if you go from E8 to the affine version of E8, which is called E9, then these constrained fields, they become intertwined indecomposably with the supergravity fields in exceptional field theory. So there's somehow no way of separating these constrained fields from the other fields, and exceptional field theory really has to use all of them together. And this is also something that we will see when we talk about E11. So with this introduction, now let me say, just as a summary, what is the thing that we set out to do and what did we achieve? So what we wanted to do is we wanted to construct this kind of exceptional field theory for the symmetry group E11. And one reason why you might be interested in doing this is because you don't have to distinguish between external and internal space anymore. So everything is just one big object. And that's very nice, and it unifies in some sense all possible theories. So this is certainly an upside. Something why this wasn't done, or why it's hard to do this, is because this E11 is a Kac-Moody symmetry group, which is not Kac-Moody in the current algebra sense or affine sense, but it's really one of these general Kac-Moody algebras. And so this is one complication, and another complication is related to these constrained fields that I just mentioned on the previous slide. So this is why we had to work quite a bit to make it succeed, but eventually we did. And our work uses some prior ideas and insights. In particular, we use some ideas that are related or are present in the work of Peter West when he talks about E11 symmetry. So we use some of these ideas, and then we use also heavily things that are related to this tensor hierarchy, which can be turned into an algebra through work of Jakob Palmquist. And as I was saying, we will use things for these constraint fields that were found in E9. And yes, so the result that we have is that we can write down a theory that is invariant, gauge invariant, under all these generalized diffeomorphisms. And to describe the dynamics, you need two ingredients. So one ingredient is you need a pseudo Lagrangian. In some sense, when you think of E11, it's like some people would say like reduction to zero dimensions, and in zero is an even number. So you expect to have only a pseudo Lagrangian and not a proper Lagrangian that implements the symmetry. So we find a pseudo Lagrangian whose Euler-Lagrange equations are you take as equations of motion, but they have to be supplemented by duality equations. And they are sometimes called twisted duality equations. So we find both these ingredients for the dynamics and show that they're invariant under these diffeomorphisms. And then in order to make sense of this somewhat baroque model, let's say, that we find, is we make sure that what we constructed actually contains 11-dimensional supergravity and all the other exceptional field theory within it. So realizing what I was saying in the beginning, you're trying to find something that unifies all possible theories in one go. So we check this for two particular instances. And we do find quite a number of mathematical identities along the way. Now, yes, so now I've become a bit more technical, and E11 is an infinite dimensional Kac-Moody algebra, and it's one of these algebras that is defined by generators and relations, which means you know it exists, you know some of its properties, but you don't know how to, for example, write down all possible generators, or how to write down the structure constants in detail. Here you see the diagram. This defines the algebra. And yeah, so we know there are generators, T alpha, infinitely many of them, with some structure constants, but there's no simple formula for them. And we know this algebra has a Killing form, which is non-degenerate. So this information alone is sufficient to make sure that you can define representations of the algebra. So here I wrote on the adjoint representation, but it's also important to know that there are highest and lowest weight representations, and these are just labeled by the highest weight. The lowest weight I write with this conjugate thing. And the highest weight is just some non-negative integer linear combination of the fundamental weights as always. So this is something that you know on general ground, so just abstractly, but of course, if you want to work with it, it's you want to be a bit more hands-on. And this way to be hands-on is to consider what is known as a level or as a graded decomposition. The symmetry algebra E11, of course, has subalgebras, and one particular subalgebra I've depicted here, which is GL11, which you obtain by simply denoting this or ignoring this node of the diagram. So this line here corresponds to GL11, and because it's a subalgebra, you can write all objects in terms of this subalgebra. You just consider the branching problem. And if you do this for this adjoint representation, you find a list of generators that is, these are all GL11 tensors, and they go all the way to minus infinity and to plus infinity. Whereas for the highest weight representations, you find another list of tensors, but they stop on one side and only go infinitely in the other side because it's highest weight. And now let me tell you a bit more about what these objects are. So this is what would be called level zero. This is just the adjoint of GL11, and which I've written in this way. And then there are infinitely many positive and negative levels. The first positive level is an antisymmetric three-form representation of GL11. And of course, this rings a bell for 11-dimensional supergravity. The next one is a six form, which in 11 dimensions is dual to a three form. And the next one up is called the dual graviton. So this is a mixed symmetry tensor of GL11, but this list continues forever, and there's no known structure or pattern in this list. But because of this close resemblance of the first few things with things you know from 11-dimensional supergravity, this is why people believe strongly that this algebra should somehow be related to 11-dimensional supergravity. And we will see in what way this is true for us.
Axel, one quick question.
Yes.
What determines the grading in this case?
The grading.
One upper index and one lower index, roughly, you know, brutally, but the rest?
So the grading here actually is the eigenvalue of a certain Cartan element, which is associated with this node here. So it's really an eigenvalue of a semi-simple thing, but you could easily say, so for this adjoint, it's the number of upper indices minus the number of lower indices divided by 3. But for this thing down here, so I haven't told you yet what the level here is. So here there's a certain shift that comes in, but you also see from each step to the next, there's just a shift of 1 in this level. But the abstract definition is it's just the eigenvalue of a certain element of the algebra, which is associated with this node.
Thank you.
Yeah, so let's talk about this highest weight representation. And I picked the particular example R lambda 1. So lambda 1 is this node here. And if you do this this graded decomposition or level decomposition, you find a certain set of GL11 tensors. And the first one, in some sense, the top one, because it's the highest weight representation that you find, is just a vector of GL11. And then you find a 2 form and a 5 form. And of course, this is also something that people who have thought about like supergravity will like, because these are just like the elements in the supersymmetry algebra. So this is like the 11-dimensional translation generator, which corresponds to 11-dimensional coordinates. And the others are like the 2 and the 5 form central charges in the supersymmetry algebra. So these are just there to give you some idea of these abstract E11 objects that I will discuss, that they mean something very concrete once you specialize to a certain subalgebra. So now, before we were saying we have to extend the geometry, and what we will do is the same that West is doing in his construction. So we take the extended geometry with coordinates in this representation that I was showing you on the previous slide, for the simple reason that we know this one starts out with the usual 11-dimensional coordinates, and then it has infinitely many embellishments. So we have this infinitely extended space that we're working on, and we have this generalized metric given in terms of some coset element V, and I didn't write it, V is in E11 over K of E11, and this thing in the middle here is like the generalization of the Minkowski metric. So there's, because you want to have a Lorentz signature or at least one time direction, you have to put a non-trivial metric, and you can show that it exists in the middle here when you construct from the field line the metric. And now in this setup here, you take this generalized metric, it depends on all these extended coordinates. And now the action of the symmetry group is just you act on the sort of adjoint indices of the scalars of this generalized metric, and you also act on the coordinates. So this is just the finite group action version of what we were seeing in the generalized Lie derivative. So this is how this transforms under rigid E11. Sometimes this is called the nonlinear realization of the semi-direct product, but what this means is just you act on the coordinates and on the fields at the same time. Now, so now we have this field M, this generalized metric that lives on this extended space. We can construct its associated current M inverse dm. And the point that I'm emphasizing here is that normally you would say this is something that takes values in the adjoint, and that's of course true. So here I've expanded it out in terms of the adjoint generators. But since the coordinates also transform, actually it takes values in the tensor product of the coordinate or dual coordinate module, because it's a derivative with the adjoint. So it has both indices M and alpha here transform under the symmetry. And so it's not just a coset model that is taking values in some abstract target space, but actually the target space also transforms under the coset symmetries. And it will be useful, and I'm mainly introducing this because I need these symbols in a second, to write the generators in the representation. So we know this is a representation R of lambda 1 of E11, which means that in this representation, the generators take a very, there are matrices, which I will write as T alpha, and these are the matrix indices MN that transform the coordinates. M becomes now a symmetric matrix in that representation. Of course, it's an infinite by infinite matrix. And this M inverse DM for the Cartan form, you can also write in this representation. And let me also write, this is why I needed these symbols for you, the section constraint. So in this extended E11 geometry, you also need a section constraint. And here I've written it out in indices completely. So this is the generalization or the explicit incarnation of this DM tensor DN restricted to a certain modulus zero. This is when you write it out in this example. Okay, so now we have some of our ingredients. You can look at the generalized Lie derivative now. So this would be the usual Lie derivative of a metric. Everything is generalized now. So there's a transport term from the action on the coordinates. And then there is this rotation term where you take d xi, so you take a derivative of xi, construct an adjoint element out of it, and then act with this adjoint group action from the left and from the right on the metric. So this is exactly the same formula that you know for the Lie derivative of the metric, now written in this slightly more abstract form. And this is a perfectly nice and covariant gauge transformation. Of course, when you construct the current, which is like inverse metric d metric, this is a bit like the Levi-Civita connection, if you wish, this no longer transforms covariantly under diffeomorphisms or generalized diffeomorphisms. So there's a covariant piece that I write as the Lie derivative, and then there's a non-covariant piece with second derivative of the gauge parameter. And now the question is, so these are standard ingredients, how can you construct a theory? How can you write down gauge invariant dynamics with these ingredients? Of course, the first impulse would be to say, from the analogy I made, this thing here is a bit like a Levi-Civita connection, so why not go to curvatures? And I think it's not fully proved, but I'm pretty sure that because of the infinite dimensional nature of E11, if you go far enough in this expansion of the levels that I was showing you in some cases before, what you will find is that you need infinite order of derivatives in order to construct something that is actually gauge invariant. So there's no obvious, let's say, second order derivative curvature tensor that you can write down in terms of these, in terms of the metric and the derivatives that becomes gauge invariant. So this is because somehow equations of motion with infinite order are a bit scary to me. This is not the way that I believe one should go. So this has been realized in a slightly related context also by West. And what he's proposing is to not, in some sense, not worry so much about the gauge invariant. So he says, why not work with gauge variant equations that he calls modulo equations. So I hope I'm representing his statement correctly. That he calls modulo equations, and then this sort of gauge dependence or gauge variance is something that you can sometimes get rid of by taking additional derivatives, which in examples goes in the direction of curvatures. But in exceptional field theory, this is a general problem, and the answer in that context is that you introduce additional fields. So with these additional fields that I also already mentioned as constraint fields, this is what I will do today, that have a kind of Stückelberg coupling, you can.
So your time is close to getting to an end. I don't know how much more do you need.
Can I have 5 more minutes? Is that too greedy?
Okay, let's do it.
So there is, so we just introduce extra fields. Where these extra fields come from is from this tensor hierarchy algebra that I was alluding to before. And I will not give you all the details of that. But what I want to emphasize is that there is a tensor hierarchy algebra where there is an indecomposable sum of representations. So in the tensor hierarchy algebra, you are forced to consider not only these current components, J, which are related with E11, but there are things that are intertwined indecomposably with E11 in this indecomposable sum. So you cannot block diagonalize this matrix over E11. And this, the fact that there are these extra things that you cannot get rid of, they tell you that there is, if you want to write down a duality equation in terms of some field strength, so the field strength here is something that you need to define, but otherwise all the objects in the equation make sense. So if you want to write down a certain field strength for the duality equation, you need to consider more than just the current component. So you cannot just take the current and say you construct a field strength only with E11, you have to add extra fields. And these extra fields are constrained on this index M in the same way. But if you do this, so you define these field strengths now using this indecomposable structure, and there's a little extra circle that I'm not explaining, you can show that the duality equation is gauge invariant. This hinges on a certain identity that we are very convinced of, but we don't have full proof. So this is one half that I was saying of the dynamics. So you have to have the duality equation, and then the other half is the pseudo-Lagrangian. So the pseudo-Lagrangian can be written in terms of four pieces, and this is for the people who have seen exceptional field theory Lagrangians, a very typical structure. So there are some potential terms, kinetic and topological terms. And they are constructed out of the current components, but they're also constructed out of these constrained fields and involve certain E11 tensors. So so we can write down all these different terms, and I'm just flashing them very quickly. Here there's the kinetic term, which is like a field strength square term up to certain corrections. And there's a topological term, and topological in the sense that there is no dependence on this generalized metric. So with this thing, we can show that all the terms that I wrote in this unique combination, they are gauge invariant together. So this is a proper gauge invariant pseudo-Lagrangian, I mean gauge invariant up to density. The Lagrangian is consistent with the duality equations. And moreover, if you take the equations that comes from there, they help you to actually recover 11-dimensional supergravity. So this is, maybe I'll just state it as the result. So you can massage the Lagrangian in such a way that you tease out the 11-dimensional supergravity action up to an infinite number of terms, but they all can be disregarded on the duality equation that you pose on the side. This is only a pseudo-Lagrangian, and all these infinitely many terms here you can ignore. So then you get exactly 11-dimensional supergravity. Good. So let me summarize and repeat. So we constructed this theory, and it has all the right symmetries. There are certain ingredients that we need and that go beyond what has been considered in some other papers, but is very much in spirit similar to what is done in exceptional field theory. We have shown that it reduces to 11-dimensional supergravity. It helps us to understand dualization of gravity better. This is something that I did not explain. And then there are some technical assumptions that we only have partial proof of. And I just list here a few things that you could imagine doing next with this thing. Спасибо.
Thank you very much. If there are no objections from the audience, since we went a bit further with this talk, I would reserve the questions, I have several actually myself, to the discussion session, and let Slava Didenko start his talk. But if you think otherwise, I'm open to...
Well, August, I admit that, it's Misha, I admit that some people could just be coming for a particular talk, so maybe it's better to keep
us. We are on time, no? We are sharp on time now, or not? What do you? Am I advancing or am I precise? I thought I was precise.
Probably Slava's talk should start in 10 minutes, I guess.
Okay, then I apologize for that. I misunderstood the. Let's see.
So we can maybe ask questions right now, and maybe.
No, you're right, because it's scheduled to that. So I should also apologize to Juan, because probably I could have left a bit more time. I had the schedule in front of me, but I was pressing. So Axel, please, if there are questions, I have several, but I can reserve my questions for the discussion session. Thank you, Misha.
So may I ask some questions?
Let's do it even with
yes. So thank you. Okay. Axel, the first question is about this pseudo-Lagrangian. As far as I understand, you have infinitely many coordinates. What is the measure you assume to integrate this Lagrangian?
So yeah, that's a very good question. So we're not proposing to actually do a path integral with this Lagrangian. So the way that we want to use it is just to generate Euler-Lagrange equations from it. So we look at the variation of that and use it to generate Euler-Lagrange equations. And this is what we're interested in. And then something that you also have to impose always on top of that is this section constraint that I was mentioning. But we're not having in mind integrating over this. So there's no good geometrical measure, no square root of g or anything like that. Yeah.
Yeah, and second question is about just this section constraint, because it has some very special form when you write it in terms of coordinate indices. Mm-hmm. It is derivatives in direct product minus 1 over 2 derivatives with exchanged indices. Mm-hmm. Can you give some idea why it should be minus 1 over 2?
So this minus 1 over 2 is indeed specific here to E11, and it comes out because of the coordinate representation that we chose. So there's a general formula for any group and any representation, and it's always related to the Casimir of the representation of the coordinate module that you choose. And here this 1/2 is just related to the Casimir of the coordinate module.
Yeah, thank you. And the third very short question is that, again, you have these infinitely many coordinates. So your fields are dependent on these infinitely many coordinates. Do you have some symmetries to gauge away this coordinate dependence or something how to live with only 11 coordinates, for example?
So you always have to impose the section constraint, and the only solutions to the section constraint that are known, and I think one can actually prove this, are such that you only keep a finite number of them. So there's no solution.
You do not have still the proof of this.
I'm pretty sure there is a proof, which is by decompactification. So you say, let's assume there's one coordinate that the fields depend on, and then can I have another coordinate that it depends on? And then you try to add and add and add, and then at some point you see you come to a limit, and this is after 11. So this is my understanding that, or my proof that this is actually the most or the biggest solution that you can have. Let me say maybe one short thing about this on top, which might be interesting, which is this section constraint you can actually understand as a condition for a certain orbit of the algebra. So the algebra acts on the coordinate module. So you have this space that I called R lambda 1, the symmetry acts on that. And you can decompose the action of the group on that module into certain orbits. And what this condition means is that you sort of only look at the smallest possible orbit, namely at the orbit of the highest weight element. And then the maximal linear tangent space to that orbit is 11 dimensional. I don't know whether this helps geometrically or not, but this is another way of thinking about the same thing.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask?
Yes, please, sir.
I'm not an expert. Just to understand, if I understood correctly from the previous discussion, that you construct something in infinite dimensional space, but your goal is to construct something in 11 dimensional space, right? That's what you want to do. Was my understanding correct?
So we construct something that is formally in an infinite dimensional space, and then we want to look at this thing formally in the infinite dimensional space when we restrict it to certain subspaces of the infinite dimensional space. And these subspaces are the ones that are allowed by this section constraint. And one possible thing is 11 dimensions, another one is 10 dimensions type 2b or something.
So you want to construct some new either 10 dimensional or 11 dimensional symmetry, which has all this very large algebraic symmetries. That's your goal, but you haven't done it yet. Was my understanding correct now?
No, I think so. What we have done is we have constructed this thing in the infinite dimensional space that has all the right symmetries, but this is just a formal thing, and you have to impose the section constraint. And when you impose the section constraint and solve it in a specific way, and you have to solve it always, then you also break the big symmetry. So what I have, what we have achieved is really an understanding of, and this is not only what we have done, but what everybody in exceptional field theory has done, by going to the bigger space, finding a kind of geometric origin of these Cremer-Julliard kind of symmetries. So, so that, and we have constructed this for E11.
Just, you know, for me, it's difficult to realize what is a field theory in infinite dimensional space, and you still haven't answered. So you say that, are you happy with that? Or, after imposing the section constraints, as you said, do you hope to obtain something else?
So yeah, I think this is something that I should emphasize. First of all that we are doing, I mean, this is really a completely classical thing. So we're not doing field theory with path integrals, and that's related to the question that Igor Bandos has asked. So we're not proposing actually to have a field theory in infinite dimensional space that we quantize.
Well, so yeah, I'm not about asking about quantization, but field theory is formulated in some in two dimension and four dimension and eight dimension, and you have infinite number of dimensions, and that's something which well, is new for me. Mm-hmm. Now, have I understood correctly that that's some intermediate, how to say, achievement to derive some field theory, maybe in 10-dimensional space, maybe in 11-dimensional space? I understand that you are doing classical field theory. It is field theory, but classical field theory, right?
Yeah.
So have I understood it correctly?
So we write down something that is in an infinite dimensional space, but this thing that we write down always has to be supplemented by this section condition.
And that's your next task. That's what you are going to do, right?
No, no, that is already incorporated into everything that I was saying.
Well, okay, thank you. Maybe in the discussion section.
So we have a formalism that informally lives on this or uses this infinite dimensional space. But whenever we want to look at the explicit expressions, we can manipulate them in the infinite dimensional space. But we know, in order to put physical or pull physical meaning out of the equations, we also have to solve the section constraint. And once we solve it, we are no longer in an infinite dimensional space, but in a finite dimensional space.
I understand, but you haven't solved it, them yet, or have you?
No, we have solutions to the section constraint. And when you do this, one thing that you get from this, I mean, one, you can solve the section constraint in different ways. And something that I had to rush over a bit is that we looked at one particular solution to this constraint. So we start with the infinite dimensional equations in infinite dimensional space with a section constraint, and we pick a particular solution to the section constraint. And this is the one that corresponds to 11-dimensional space-time. And then these equations that formerly were written on an infinite dimensional space, they reduce just to equations on 11 dimensions, and then they are the supergravity equations.
And this 11-dimensional theory, which you obtain, it's different from 11-dimensional supergravity, which I guess the Lagrangian is known.
No, it's exactly 11-dimensional supergravity.
Okay, thank you, now I understood.
Yeah,
okay. Sorry.
Please.
It's now also abiding to Misha's comment, I think we can move to Slava Didenko if he's here.